I'm designing these brief video lectures to supplement your reading and the weekly videos that you watch. Instead of repeating the material you're reading and viewing, I want to present additional facts, sometimes serious, sometimes humorous. I think Mark Knoll's book is terrific, but it assumes you have some knowledge of American Christian history. So I encourage you to locate and browse surveys of American history or American Christian history or both. Browsing means simply just skimming through the book, even if all you do is look at the pictures, maps, and sidebars. It is popular mythology to believe most of Europe believed the earth was flat. Perhaps some in the backwaters did so, but the majority of educated European society knew the earth was spherical. Ancient Greeks as early as the 6th century BC philosophically believed in a spherical planet. By the 3rd century BC, Hellenistic astronomy settled the issue. Some in the church held to a flat earth because of a mistaken understanding of Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22. That scripture says, "It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in." Although this verse could be taken to describe the earth as seen here, it could also describe a planet that is round or spherical. By the late Middle Ages, nearly every fair observer understood the earth as a sphere. They did, however, think it was much smaller. It is sometimes amazing to realize European voyages of discovery began before the Protestant Reformation in Germany. Martin Luther nailed his 95 Theses for debate to the Wittenberg chapel door some 24 years after Columbus set sail for the New World. While Columbus was not the first European to discover the continents of the Western Hemisphere, he receives most of the credit. In reality, Scandinavians settled Greenland and Newfoundland long before Columbus raised the funds for his voyages. Maps that circulated throughout Europe revealed the globe as a small globe, small planet, yet consisting of small land masses. Europeans referred to their understanding of a smallish planet as Orbis Terrarum. Orbis Terrarum said water made up most of the globe, with small land masses. Most maps from the era, like this one, show Europe, portions of Africa, Asia, and the Middle East surrounded by the oceans. In an effort to portray European superiority, cartographers of that day often portrayed Europe much larger, far out of proportion to the rest of the known world. Europeans speculated about an undiscovered world if, in fact, something existed between Europe and Asia. The Catholic Church, however, exercised its authority and tried to squelch such rumors. In spite of church pressure, European folklore spoke of stories of fantastic lands and people who inhabited an unknown world west of Europe. No one knew what might be found in the uncharted waters to the west. Romantic stories similar to the fabled city of Atlantis filled their minds. Plato, the Greek philosopher, first told about Atlantis in two of his works. The question remains, did Plato write his stories based on fact, or were they pure fiction? According to Plato, the founders of Atlantis lived 9,000 years before he did, and were half god and half man. The city boasted of tremendous naval power, and was comprised of a great city built on concentric islands. Europeans also considered the possibility of the Garden of Eden, that it too might exist somewhere over the western horizon. Spiritually minded Europeans believed heaven, populated by the righteous dead, existed somewhere out there over the horizon. If not heaven, then maybe hell was out there. A hell populated by demons or monsters might be found. Stories suggested there were extra-human or supra-human creatures living on uncharted islands. Sailors feared once they lost sight of Europe's coast that they would find frightening sea monsters. The point to make here is that Europeans thought about the unknown in much the same way we often do. They looked at the unknown through the lens of their personal existence and comprehension. What lay over the distant vista was either innocent or evil, good or bad, divine or devil. We think of the future in terms of Star Trek and fantastic unknown galaxies or civilizations as in Star Wars. Why not recognize those in the past had their own vision of what lay in the unknown? Christopher Columbus didn't buy any of the legends, myths, or stories. He believed water alone separated Europe from the Orient. Believing in Orbis Terrarum, he was convinced he could sail west and in short order reach Asia. He knew something of Africa because of the exploration of Portuguese sailors. He also knew China's coastline, located roughly west of Spain, ran north and south. All he needed was ships and sailors, and he could prove his convictions true. Beginning in the 1480s, Columbus tried to obtain support for a Western venture. In time, he played on Queen Isabella's desire to discover new lands and to colonize and evangelize those new lands. Isabella provided funds for three small ships, the Niña, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. The Santa Maria was a cargo vessel with four masts, although some historians suggest it only had three. The vessel was about 58 feet long and could carry about 100 tons of cargo. It was a slow ship, but it was a ship that Columbus used as his flagship, even though he never really liked it. On the return trip, the Santa Maria ran aground and sank off present-day Haiti. Wood from the ship was later used to build a fort near the site. The other two ships were caravels, smaller vessels originally built for commerce in the Mediterranean Sea. Columbus favored La Niña, which later became the flagship for further exploration in the Western Hemisphere. The Pinta returned to Spain, then disappeared from history. Columbus kept his first voyage strictly secular. That is, there were no clergy on board any of the three ships. The crew did, however, observe daily Vesper services. Columbus and the crews first landed in the Canary Islands, then set out to the west. First landing on Watling Island on October 12, 1492, the crews came into contact with the Taino tribe, whom Columbus promptly called Indians, thinking he had reached Asian shores. Still thinking in terms of Orbis Terrarum, Columbus decided he reached the southern part of Japan. He returned to Spain without the riches he expected to find, and he described the natives in terms of the popular mythologies of the day. He described them as innocents and painted a picture of them as almost angelic beings. It took some doing, but Columbus ultimately got permission for a second voyage. The expedition consisted of 17 ships with approximately 1,500 colonists on board. He eventually settled the colonists on the island of Hispaniola. On this voyage, however, he hit Cuba. Cuba sits east and west rather than north and south like the coastline of China. Uncertain and confused, Columbus believed he had landed on the Malay Peninsula. For a variety of reasons, on his third voyage, Columbus transported convicts as colonists. There had been bad reports coming back to Spain from Hispaniola, thus the decision to take convicts. He sailed farther south, making landfall at Trinidad, then sailed across the mouth of the Orinoco River in Venezuela. He then realized he had seen a continent. He returned to Hispaniola, where he remained in the colony for a time, then returned to Spain about 1500. Columbus knew he could not explain any of his experiences by the concept of Orbis Terrarum. Still, the European scientific community and the Church specifically stated that no landmass existed between Europe and Asia. Unable to explain any of this, Columbus concluded he had come into contact with the Garden of Eden. So, in three voyages, Columbus landed in Japan, Malaysia, and the Garden of Eden. Columbus hoped his fourth voyage would explain all of it. He sailed south of Japan, north of the Garden of Eden, only to hit the coast of Honduras in Central America. He was then marooned in Jamaica for a time and then returned to Spain, confused and hopeless. He died in relative neglect after failing to collect any of the titles and lands that the king and queen had promised him. Subsequent exploration fared little better. Amerigo Vespucci sailed on an exploratory voyage as navigator. He believed Columbus was a terrible navigator, but when his ship contacted Brazil, Vespucci was left as confused as Columbus. He first stated there had to be another continent there, but when the church raised charges of heresy against him, he recanted. Although Vespucci gave his name, Amerigo, to the American continents, he did not discover America. Finally, Peter, who's also known as Peter Martyr or Peter Vermigli, a Reformed theologian, challenged the church, insisting another continent existed between Europe and Asia. Vermigli published his theory in 1507, and it was ultimately accepted. In a sense, it's said, Peter Martyr discovered America. The significance of all this is the fact Europe's educated see America in light of their personal values, scientific knowledge, and religious faith. They could not and did not see the discovery on its own terms. When Europeans met Native Americans, they remembered the old stories and saw them as either innocents or demons. There couldn't be any middle ground. Native Americans couldn't be fully human. It's no accident that the English theologian and writer Thomas More set his utopia on an island in the Caribbean. More believed you could attain perfection in the New World. Hernando Cortes complicated the picture for Europe when he returned to Spain with reports of fabulous wealth. John Cabot said he heard of a crystal mountain in the New World. Europeans simply did not know what to believe. Why not a fountain of youth? Why not cities of gold? All of Europe's presuppositions fly out of the window because the New World challenged every conception of the ordinary.